come back, then I'll start.
So, Professor Panigrahi, all well? You're going so nice?
Yeah, looks like all well. I mean, I am learning personally. I must say I'm very selfish because, you know, these talks are very... By the way, Deepankar, you can see Professor Sugisaki who has joined. So he's associated, I saw he's associated with this new center coming up, which Bhanu Das is leading, so I think Professor Sugisaki will be a visiting professor there. So I think soon we are going to, see him and, interact with him also. Because Bhanu's center...
Where is he joining?
Center for Quantum Computation, I'm forgetting the exact name.
Oh, okay.
You know, this Chatterjee group.
Okay. Oh, so who is joining, you say?
See, center's name I don't remember. They have declared the name. They have some programs starting.
Okay. So who is joining, you say?
Professor Sugisaki. You can see, his picture is there.
Okay.
He's here now online.
He's now online and we'll get to know him more.
Okay. Very good.
So it's a real pleasure to introduce Professor Guru Prasad Kar and as Alok and me were joking, truly to the Indian audience, Professor Kar doesn't need an introduction. And, I got to know about his work. So Subhashis was offered a faculty position in PRM. And at that time, there was a, CSIR school on quantum computation. And then, slowly you get to know about his work because he's not the kind of person who, sort of advertises his work or anything. You get to know through his students, through his collaborators, and slowly you find out the depth of his understanding of quantum information. If anybody who truly has a grip of quantum information and you can go to him whenever you have any difficulty, it's Professor Paul in India. And, when I'm saying India, I mean, it's not like others cannot approach him because he's very, very approachable. And, one more thing I would say that the school which we are conducting right now here, this was essentially Guru's contribution to this quantum information during summer, because two summers I remember, one summer, quite a few of my students I recommended, they went there and attended his talks, series of talks. I also gave some talks there. Out of that, Swahan Roy Maulik went abroad, finished his PhD in Oxford. Now going to University of California, Berkeley, quantum information. Another boy, Manav Putra, who just finished his master's in ISER, going to Syracuse. And second batch, similarly, quite a few students, I remember personally, from those schools, they have benefited, they have gone on to do their higher studies in quantum information. And apart from that, so I will request Professor Paul to take over and give his talk.
Yeah, let me share the screen.
Guru, make it full screen. Yeah, okay, perfect.
It's okay, huh? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So let me thank Professor Panigrahi for his introduction and at the same time for organizing such a summer school at this scale. And also I congratulate other organizers organizing this big program. For some urgent works in my department, I could not attend all the lectures, maybe one, two lectures I attended, but it is quite a powerful effort for the students. And I have prepared my talks, though maybe there are many educated people or expert people participating in this conference. But I have prepared my talks, we can say that exclusively for students. So it is very simple talk. let me pause it. So it is about understanding quantum non-locality. And I have organized my talk in this fashion that quantum mechanics is a probabilistic theory, and it is irreducibly probabilistic. But at the same time, if someone tells that no, nature is deterministic, then it is also true that quantum mechanics is powerless to discard a deterministic model for the nature. Maybe von Neumann in 1932 thought that no, you cannot have a deterministic theory for the nature. But he was wrong. He was wrong, that was shown, or his assumption was wrong, that was shown by Bell long after his von Neumann's theorem. But it is indeed true that quantum mechanics is powerless to discard a deterministic model. Then I will discuss very briefly what Einstein, Podolsky, and Rosen wanted to establish. Then we'll come to the main points posed by John Bell, and from where actually the idea of non-locality, quantum non-locality, arises. So we come to quantum non-locality. Then we'll try to understand sometimes what happens, this derivation of Bell's inequality, its violation, all this discussion. With all these discussions, sometimes the main point is lost to some of the students. That's why we'll try to understand quantum non-locality through some pseudo-telepathy game, which is easier for understanding these basics of non-locality. And we are for this development, we are actually indebted to Popescu and Rolle, who discovered a correlation which is no signaling, but at the same time, it is very, very powerful non-local correlation, but unfortunately, it does not exist in nature. But to understand non-locality, it is very, very important at the same time. And then we'll conclude. And in my talk, I have assumed that the basic formalism of quantum mechanics has been discussed, or students know it. That I will assume. Yeah. So let's not start with a state. State gets zero. By gets zero, I mean, and you also mean that it is up eigenstate of sigma z. Now, if someone tells, is there a quantum state for which observable is deterministic? Yeah. There may be a state for which some observable may take deterministic value. And it is indeed happen when it is in one of the eigenstate of the observable. So if you consider this up eigenstate of zero, sigma z, then sigma z can be considered as property of the individual system, because then you know if you measure sigma z, you are certain to get up result. That means result plus one. So for quantum mechanics, deterministic value can be assigned, but for some time. Sometime for some observable. And especially if it is in the eigenstate of the corresponding observable. So for this state, you can assign a value to sigma z. So value of sigma z, if the quantum state is in the state zero, then you can write it is equal to plus one. But for the same state, sigma x is not a reality. According to a standard interpretation of quantum mechanics, or popularly known as Copenhagen interpretation of quantum mechanics. They tell if you take the state zero, then sigma j does not have reality. Sigma j does not, if a particle is prepared in the state zero, then if you ask this question, what is the value of sigma x, then quantum mechanics will tell, no, it does not have a value. And it will have a value only when you perform a measurement. That means before the measurement, it does not have any reality. Measurements, performing measurements will create the reality for sigma x. So measurement does not, so in this case, according to a standard interpretation of quantum mechanics, measurement does not reveal a pre-existing property as this value of sigma x for the state zero cannot be defined in standard quantum mechanics. But from here, if someone, as von Neumann did, come to the conclusion that quantum mechanics prove that a single particle cannot have a definite value for sigma x when it is in the state zero, then this is something more that someone is demanding. In a standard quantum mechanics, sigma x has no reality. But if you tell that in nature, this particle has no reality for sigma x, that cannot be established by just one telling quantum mechanics. If that is true, then you have to show. You have to prove. Quantum mechanics is a theory where, of course, for this quantum state, sigma x does not have a reality. But if you want to tell that it is the final thing, that a single, for a single qubit, if it has a reality for sigma z, then it cannot have a reality for sigma x, then it has to be proved by something else. Just if you tell that quantum mechanics, according to quantum mechanics, it does not have, that is the final thing. No. At least it is not a, it cannot be a logical conclusion. So if someone claims that for individual system, both sigma j and sigma x have pre-existing property in the following, in which way? It is like if someone prepares a large number of particles in the state zero, then nature is such, nature behaves in such a way that 50% of the particle, of course, then 100% of the particle have reality for sigma z, which is equal to plus one. But nature is such that if you prepare this state for same state, then 50% of the particle also has the property sigma x, which is plus one, and another 50, again, they have also reality for sigma x, definite value for sigma x, which is minus one. Then how can quantum mechanics contradict this statement? If someone behaves in this way, if someone thinks in this way, that okay, if you prepare the state zero, if you prepare many particles in the same state zero, then nature is such, nature behaves in such a way that 50% of the particle has reality also for sigma x, which is plus one, and another 50% minus one. Then for the experiment, you will get the same thing. So how quantum mechanics will discard it? So the scenario is something like this. I don't know how to get rid. So scenario is something like this, that maybe the quantum state does not refer to the individual particle. There is another parameter which we don't know, or which nature does not allow you to know. So there may be another parameter. And if we know both the parameter, psi as well as lambda, then we will know definite value for all observable for a single quantum system. Something like this. If you consider spin, then it will be like this, that If we know the full description of the state, then value of any sigma n in the state psi and lambda will be definite, either plus one or minus one. But quantum mechanics is compatible with measurement results. So whatever fundamental theory you construct, it has to reproduce this quantum mechanical bond probability or bond, this expectation value has to be reproduced. So this equation has to be satisfied where this rho lambda is the probability distribution of lambda. And it has to be a positive function, and this it has to be a probability function. So it has to satisfy this quantum condition. That means it has to reproduce quantum statistics, because quantum statistics is compatible with measurement results. Question is whether such kind of theory is possible, and von Neumann clearly tried to prove that you cannot. Now question is, does uncertainty principle prohibit the existence of such a theory? The answer is clearly no, and already we have discussed. Because uncertainty tells, if you translate uncertainty in terms of two spin observable sigma x and sigma z, then if one of them is very certain, then another is very uncertain, like position and momentum. If position is very certain, then momentum becomes very uncertain. And if momentum becomes very certain, then position becomes very uncertain. Maybe this is the very simple meaning of uncertainty relation, though uncertainty relation may have other implications which we are not going to discuss in our this talk. So, as I told earlier, if one prepares an ensemble in the quantum state zero, then 50% of the system will be in the up spin state and 50% of them will be down spin state for sigma x, as we discussed earlier. So, what we are trying to tell, that uncertainty principle cannot tell that you cannot have a more fundamental theory than quantum mechanics. Does complementarity principle prohibit such a theory? Again, the answer is no. Complementarity principle tells, at least in terms of position, momentum, or spin measurement along different directions, it tells that in quantum mechanics, you cannot jointly measure sigma z and sigma x. That means the arrangement to measure sigma z and sigma x are mutually exclusive. And the general statement is that this in quantum mechanics, some observable cannot be measured jointly. Sigma z, sigma x are example. Position and momentum pair is another example. But how can this prohibit the system to have definite values for both sigma z and sigma x? Of course, nature does not allow you to measure sigma z and sigma x jointly, simultaneously. But how this statement can tell that particle cannot have a definite value for sigma z and sigma x? It cannot be a logical statement. So, neither uncertainty principle nor complementarity principle can prohibit the existence of a deterministic theory. So the picture will be something like this, that if you prepare a quantum system in a state psi, you are thinking that you are preparing the particle, all the particle in the same state. Of course, they will be same in terms of the psi parameter, quantum state, but they may be different in terms of the other parameter like lambda. I'm not going in details for this thing, but Bell, actually, the paper might have been written long back, but it was published in 1966 in Review Modern Physics. Bell actually constructed a model where he considered the completed state or fundamental state to be the collection of two parameters. One is quantum state itself, another is a vector, but later Beltrametti and Cassinetti showed that you can take it to be a scalar also. So Bell could construct a model where if you know both the parameter, then for all observable, you know the definite values of all sigmas. If you know psi, then you cannot know the values of all observable. But if you know both the parameters, psi as well as lambda, then for every observable, if you have a definite value. And Bell model was something like this, where psi is a polarized state, whose polarization direction is n, and let you are measuring your observable spin observable along some direction m, then this is the Bell model. So n is the state parameter, m is the direction for the spin observable, then you can assign value, definite value, to all observable. This is a sine function, and the sine function has this property that it is 1 when x is positive or when x is non-negative, and it is -1 when x is negative. And the function is something like this. And if you ignore lambda, or you can see, you can tell that nature does not allow you to know the definite values of lambda. So what you do to get the quantum result, you integrate over lambda. And you get the exact quantum result. Here, only thing that lambda, Bell originally constructed lambda to be a vector, so that is a more complicated model, which is simpler model, where lambda takes value, scalar value from minus half to plus half. So if you integrate over this whole region, you get quantum result. So this shows that von Neumann is wrong. You can construct a deterministic theory which on the average will reproduce quantum results. Then come EPR. Because in latter part, all the researchers in foundation of quantum mechanics actually got the impetus from these Einstein's, Podolsky, and Rosen's paper. And maybe for some time, Einstein was thinking that quantum mechanics may have some contradiction with special relativity. That means maybe quantum mechanics is a signaling theory. That means instantaneous signaling is inbuilt in quantum mechanics. But somehow you are such a big scientist, he could not see such no signaling property in quantum mechanics. So, though in many debates he was thinking about quantum non-locality, but finally they came to the conclusion in 1935 that maybe quantum mechanics is an incomplete theory. To show that, they defined reality, or more precisely, we can tell that they took the sufficient condition of reality, they defined locality, they put a criterion of completeness, and from this thing, and taking an example from quantum mechanics, I mean taking a particular state from quantum mechanics, particular correlated state from quantum mechanics, they at least tried to establish that quantum mechanics is incomplete. Their definition of reality, I think most of the people have seen that if without any way disturbing a system, we can predict with certainty, that means with probability equal to 1, the value of a physical quantity, that means you can certainly tell the measurement results, then there exists an element of reality corresponding to that quantity. And locality, if systems are spatially separate, then disturbance on one system should not instantaneously affect the reality that pertains to the other system, which may be far away. And criterion of completeness means if you have some physical reality that you can establish, that means every element of physical reality must have a counterpart in physical theory. So their way of showing that quantum mechanics is incomplete, what they do, they actually take a quantum correlation from there using reality and locality. They show that there is a element of physical reality, and they show that that element of reality is not contained in quantum mechanics. That's why quantum mechanics will be an incomplete theory. So for that, they took a particular correlation, quantum correlation, which may be singlet or any maximally entangled state. I have taken not the singlet, but one maximally entangled state, which is this, which is called phi plus. And phi plus has this property that it can be written in sigma z basis, as well as it will retain the same form if you write this same state in sigma x basis. Now, due to correlation, if you could perform a measurement of sigma z on particle 1, then without disturbing the particle 2, because the particle 2 can in principle be far away, you can predict the result of sigma z for particle 2. Because of this correlation, if you perform the measurement of sigma z, if your result is up, then you collapse on 0, 0. Then for particle 2, you know the state. That's why you can certainly tell the measurement result of sigma z. And Einstein is telling that measurement on 1 cannot instantaneously change the reality of particle 2. So if we can certainly tell the sigma z value of 2, then it is a reality. And that reality has not been created by my measurement on particle 1. So that means that reality was already there. Even when the measurement was not performed, the reality was there. Otherwise, locality is violated. So if locality is a property of nature, then reality for sigma z for particle 2 was already there. But you can conclude the same thing for sigma x also, because the state can be written in the same form, even if you write it in a sigma x basis. Then you can similarly tell that if we perform measurement of sigma x on particle 1, then we can predict the reality of 2. That means for a single particle, both the reality are there, sigma z and sigma x. But in quantum mechanics, there is no state for which both can be real. Because if sigma z is real, then sigma x cannot be real. Because if sigma z to be real, it has to be in the eigenstate of sigma z. And you know, if you take eigenstate of sigma z, then sigma x cannot be real, and vice versa. So EPR is concluding that if you use reality and locality, that means local realism, that sigma z and sigma x both are real, but quantum mechanics cannot capture it. So quantum mechanics cannot capture some physical reality that we have derived. That does not mean quantum mechanics is wrong. That does not mean quantum mechanics is inconsistent. But that can tell that it can be incomplete. But Bell asked a different question. So, as I told you, that how this EPR result actually influenced the latter physicist. See, we are discussing about psi lambda. That means you are completing it. It is so psi theory is not complete. So if you give another lambda, then it becomes complete. Then if you have psi and lambda, then you can have reality for all sigma z, sigma x, sigma s. For all of them, you will have reality. And Einstein was thinking that maybe in future, that kind of complete theory will come, and quantum mechanics will be a just statistical description based on that more fundamental theory. But Bell asked a different question. Bell was asking, okay, but before coming to this conclusion that quantum mechanics could be incomplete, let us ask this question. Is quantum mechanics compatible with the idea of locality and reality that Einstein envisaged? That has to be checked first, that whether quantum mechanics is compatible with the idea of locality and reality. So this is a very, very important question. Important in the sense that this locality, assumption of locality, reality, there are some grand assumption about nature. And Bell is asking, let us test whether that assumptions are true. So this is like something like reducing philosophical question to question of physics. So before going to Bell's discovery, let us understand, if not prove, that quantum mechanics as a theory is no signaling theory. It is completely compatible with quantum mechanics. To understand that, I am considering two boxes. One box contains large number of particles. Both box contains large number of particles. In the first box, 50% of them are in up eigenstate of sigma z, and 50% of them are in down eigenstate of sigma z. In the other box, 50% of them are in up eigenstate of sigma x, 50% of them are in down eigenstate of sigma x, and they are mixed. Then, if I give you this box containing a large number of particles, but without telling which box I have given to you, can you tell me by performing measurement which box I have given to you? So one can perform measurements on all the particles, but he has to tell whether box one has been given or box two has been given. Actually, it is not possible to conclude. Because if you perform measurements on all the particles of box one or box two for any observable, all the statistics remain same. I will tell all the students to work out this problem and be sure that for these box one and box two, you get the same expectation value for all possible observables. So these two ensembles cannot be discriminated. And not only that, if you could discriminate between these two boxes, then actually there will be signaling. There will be instantaneous information transfer. Let us see how. You consider this, you remember this state, which can be written in same form, both for sigma z basis and sigma x basis. Let us consider a scenario. Alice and Bob. Bob is far, far away. Maybe light years, sir. And they are sharing this pi plus state, many copies of this pi plus state. And let Alice has to inform Bob. Let they are twin. So Alice has to inform Bob whether father is dead or alive. But if Bob is light years away, then that information will reach after 1 year. But let us see whether quantum mechanics allow us to send that information very quickly. So idea is something like this. If father is alive, then Alice will measure sigma z. And if father is dead, Alice will measure sigma x. Now see, for this estate, if Alice measure sigma x, sigma z, then particle 2 will either collapse on 0 or will collapse on 1. And it will happen with equal probability. So, if Alice measure sigma z on all these particles, then box particle will be a box 1 part type. I mean, this collection of particle, half of them will be in up eigenstate of sigma z and half of them will be down eigenstate of sigma z. And if father is dead, then Alice will measure sigma x on all of them. Then second box will be created on Bob's side. If Bob could discriminate between these two boxes, then he can know whether father is alive or dead within a very short time. Actually, it will, because collapse takes no time, so it will happen instantaneously, but Bob has to perform all this measurement. It will take some time. That's why it will take some time, but within a short time, information will be transferred to Bob, though Bob is maybe light years away. So these two ensembles cannot be discriminated, cannot be learned. So, but it is not a general proof. More general proof can be given where you can show that quantum mechanics is a no signaling theory. So it is compatible with special relativity or principle of relativity. Now we come to Bell's inequality, derivation of Bell's inequality. How much time do I have, Alok? Oh no, Professor Panigrahi.
So you have up to 11:30. You can give some around 20 minutes for discussion. So you can go on.
Yeah, okay. Thank you. Yeah. So the derivation of Bell's inequality, as it starts, it has nothing to do with quantum mechanics. It only assumes that you take a system comprising of two subsystems, A and B, or you give a different name, because for observable, I have taken A and B. Or you take Alice on Bob as two particles. Now you consider two observable A1 or A2 on Alice's side and B1 and B2 on Bob's side. And they have been prepared in a particular state lambda. And you consider this theory such that if you know lambda, you have definite values for A1, A2 as well as B1, B2. So you assume that measurement reveals pre-existing value like our in classical world. So that means observable already has definite value. Measurement only reveals those pre-existing values. And also observable values for a qubit, I have written here as a qubit, but you can consider it as a system. So observable values for system is independent of choice of measurement on other qubit. So if you know lambda, you know the definite value for AI as well as you know the definite value for BJs, I mean for B1 or B2 and A1 or A2. And also this value in no way depends on which measurement or which observable you consider for the other particle. So value of AI for the state lambda does not depend on observable chosen to measure on other side. So this is the assumption of locality. This is the assumption of locality. That value of AI does not depend on BJ. Similarly, value of BJ does not depend on AI. So value is predetermined. So if A1 has a definite value for lambda, that remains same whether you choose measurement B1 or B2, whatever, on the other side. This is the assumption of locality. And this is another assumption which is called free will. And from this thing, you can calculate the value of AI BJ, expectation value of AI and BJ in this fashion. And I'm not going in the details proof, this group is very simple. If you want, I can send the slide. And finally, what is proof that these if this is the assumption of reality, this is the assumption of locality, and conjunction of these two assumption leads to this inequality. That means whatever theory you consider, whatever may have its form, if this theory satisfies these two conditions of reality and locality, then statistics for observable, and observable are such that they have only two definite values, plus one or minus one. Then for all those observable, if you consider this kind of quantity, then this quantity, absolute value of this quantity is bounded by two. This is very, very general theory. You don't care about the particular structure, particular mathematical structure of the theory. Just it has these two properties, that reality is there and it obeys locality condition. With these two assumptions, you are telling that if you choose observable, whatever pair of observable you choose, the statistics should obey this inequality. This is very, very general theorem. And if it is violated by some theory, then what conclusion should we come to? If this inequality is violated, then we'll tell the assumption C I am taking as natural, so I am not discussing about the assumption of C, which is in the present context is very important, but for our discussion it is not that important. So we can, if it is violated, then we can conclude that either reality is not obeyed, or locality is not obeyed, or both are not obeyed by the theory. So there may be three conclusions. And indeed, if you choose a very particular state like singlet state, and if you choose cunningly your measurement observable, spin observable, in these four directions, then for this four spin observable, you calculate this quantity in quantum mechanics, then this absolute value of this quantity becomes 2 root 2. So indeed, it violates this Bell's inequality. So now we can come to the conclusion that quantum mechanics violates violates the assumption of locality and reality, or conjunction of reality and locality. Or in short, you can tell quantum mechanics violate local realistic theory, or quantum mechanics violate local realism. This term has been popular nowadays. Quantum mechanics, it violates local realism. This is the essence of Bell's theorem. But we can discuss it in a more elegant way. Because as I told you, because of discovery by Popescu and Rolf, let us come to that. For three particle also, we have a very, very elegant proof for quantum non-locality, very, very elegant proof. But this is so simple that you can study yourself. This is 3 qubits. And this is a very direct contradiction between local realism and quantum mechanics. And the state was discovered in 1989 by Ginberger, Horley, and Geilinger. It is 3-qubit state. And we will see clearly how it violates the local realism, but by 100%. Yeah. Now, to understand the same quantum non-locality, we'll consider a gate. This popular pseudo telepathy game. Now it has been called Bell CHS game. Bell CHSH game. The game is something like this. You consider in this game two players, Alice and Bob. The game is something like this. Alice will be given question A1 or A2. But this question is not any logical thing. Alice need not think over what answer has to be given. Because the answer can be either +1 or -1 for both the questions. Similarly, Bob, he will be given question B1 or B2. Question can be +1 or -1 for both the questions. But there is one condition in this game that after the game starts, Alice and Bob will not be allowed to communicate. I mean, their mobile will be taken off or they will be kept light years. But that is difficult to perform. That's why they will not be allowed to communicate. Now, what is the winning condition of the game? Now, this game will be played many times. I mean, pair of questions will be given Alice to Bob many times and their answers will be collected. And finally, it has to be checked whether they satisfy the winning condition. Winning condition is something like, so how many pairs will be there? How many pair of questions will be there? 4. Alice gets A1, Bob gets B1. Alice gets A1, Bob gets B2. Alice gets A2, Bob gets B1. Alice gets A2, Bob gets B2. So 4 type of pair of question may be there. And question will be given completely randomly. So 1/4 of the times, let it is 1,000 times, so 250 times, this pair will appear, A1 and B1. 250 times A1 and B2, 250 times A2 and B1, 250 times A2, B2, but they will be completely random. That's why if Alice gets A1, she does not know whether Bob gets B1 or B2. Similarly for Bob, if Bob gets either B1 or B2, he does not know what Alice got. And winning condition is something like this, that for these first 3 pairs, product of their answer has to be +1. Product of their answer has to be +1. But for the last pair, A2, B2, product of their answer has to be -1. This is same thing, that average of this thing is 4. These two are equivalent. That this 4, satisfying this 4 condition is equivalent to that this Bell quantity is equal to 4. Because if you take the average of A1, B1, it has to be always +1. So if you average over it, it will be +1. So this will be +1, this will be +1, this will be -1, but there is another minus. So this quantity will be 4. Now question is whether Alice and Bob can win this game with 100% probability. Can some student tell whether it is possible? Okay, we show that it is not possible. See how. Late at a particular turn, because you know, here it is very important that Alice has to answer for question A1 and A2 without knowing what is the question given to Bob. That's why whatever strategy they design, because before the game starts, they can sit together and design a strategy. But whatever strategy they design, it has to be local. Because when Alice answers for question A1 or A2, she does not know whether Bob is answering B1 or B2. Because at this particular turn, he does not know the question given to Bob. So their strategy has to be local. Now, if you, in a particular turn, let Alice's strategy is something like this, that her answer for A1 is this, and her answer for A2 is this, which can be either plus 1 or minus 1. Similarly, Bob's answer are these. But they don't know which pair of questions are coming to them. So if they have to win this game with 100% probability, then this set of answer has to satisfy all these four conditions. And all these four conditions cannot be satisfied, you can check. Because in all these equations, value of answer for A1 in equation 1 and answer for A1 in equation 2, they are same. Similarly for all others. So if you take the product of this equation, left-hand side will be positive because everything will be squared. Every quantity will be squared. So it will be positive. Right-hand side, it will be negative. So this set of answers cannot satisfy all these winning conditions simultaneously. So there is no way to win this game with 100% probability. Now, starting for this Bell quantity, I mean Bell's inequality, one can convert this expectation value to probability of winning this game in a very simple fashion, which I am not going to discuss. But one can show that it is equivalent to statement that this Bell's inequality is equivalent to that by any local strategy, the winning probability for this game is bounded by 3/4. This is another Bell's inequality. It's completely equivalent to Bell's inequality that by any local strategy, the probability of winning this game, this particular CHSH game, is bounded by 3/4. That means 75% is the optimal probability. And you can easily see that 75% can be trivially achieved. Because if Alice decides that she will answer always plus one for all questions, and Bob will also decide to answer always plus one for all the questions, say they satisfy all these first three conditions and only not the last one. So 75% can be trivially achieved. But Bell's inequality is telling that 75% is the highest that you can achieve by any local standard. This is very, very profound, isn't it? Yeah. So we have much little time. And quantum mechanics, of course, this Bell's inequality can be violated. So winning probability of this game will also go up, but it does not become one. It goes to 85%. Yeah. But if we design some deterministic correlation for winning this game, then you can see, so this is a deterministic correlation. It is something like this, that for A1, B1, result is plus 1, plus 1. A2, B1, plus 1, plus 1. A1, B2, plus 1, plus 1. Later you consider two magic box, and there are two inputs, and for every two inputs, there are two outputs, plus one or minus one, and box are correlated in this fashion. For these first three inputs, it is always plus one, and for the last input, first one is plus one, second one is minus one. See, if we have this kind of correlation, then of course we can win this game, because you see that product is always plus one for the first three and minus one for the last one. So it indeed satisfy the winning probability. Similarly, if you consider this correlation where first three cases it is always minus one, and for the last case it is first one is minus one, second one is plus one. This also satisfies the winning condition. So if you have a correlation like this, you can also satisfy the winning condition of the game. And also you can have another two boxes where this is minus one, this is plus one. Similarly, this is plus one, this is minus one. All this kind of correlation of course, you can win this game. And they are deterministic also. But surprisingly, they don't satisfy this no signaling condition. They don't satisfy this no signaling condition. That means they are non-local. These deterministic correlation, they are non-local. That you can see that by measuring B2, you can tell whether Alice has chosen A1 or A2. You look at the last two lines. By measuring B2 on other side, you can tell if you get minus one, then you are sure that Alice has measures A2. And if you get plus one, Alice has measured A1. So you can show in this fashion that let Alice wants to convey Bob the result of this cricket match. So their strategy is something like this. India wins, then she measures A1. If India lose, then she measures A2. And Bob always measures B2. And from the results, he will know whether Alice measures A1 or A2. And from that, they know whether he can know whether India wins or lost. And even if Bob is lighty or savvy, it can be done instantly. So it does violate the principle of relativity. So what you see? So you see, if you satisfy the winning condition of this game by any local deterministic theory, and also winning condition is such that it violates Bell's inequality. Because Bell's inequality tells you cannot go beyond two. But winning condition is such that you have to go reach four. That means you have to violate Bell's inequality. But surprisingly, if you consider Popescu-Rorlick correlation, then also you can win this game, but without violating no signaling condition. But only thing you have to sacrifice this determinism. Then what you have to replace by determinism? You have to introduce probability. So yeah, what you have to do, you have to consider equal mixture of these two deterministic correlation. So if you take equal mixture of these two deterministic correlation, then what you get, what you will be output, input, output, for input A1 and B1, you will get plus one, half of the times, and minus one, half of the times. But that does not change the product. Product still remains plus one. So it does satisfy the winning condition of the game. So this is the correlation. For A2, B1, again, this thing. For A1, B2, again, this thing. And A2, B2, it is minus one plus one with half, plus one minus one with half. And this satisfies the winning condition of the game. Though it has become probabilistic, it does satisfy winning condition of the game. And it is compatible with no signaling condition. So this is very beautiful. That you have no signaling correlation. And it violates Bell's inequality. It actually optimally violates Bell's inequality because this winning probability of this game is equal to one, is equivalent to that Bell quantity is equal to four. But, so this is a kind of quantum correlation, but this is very, very powerful correlation, which does not exist in nature. Quantum mechanics is no signaling correlation, and it is also powerful correlation. But Bell quantity is not four, but root. Now, it is you can understand Bell's inequality or a statement of the Bell's theorem very simply. This correlation is no signaling, but if you want to realize this correlation as deterministic correlation, then that deterministic correlation is something like this, and they are not local. This correlation is no signaling. But if you want to real, if you are not satisfied with this probability, you don't like probability. So what you try, you break this correlation in terms of deterministic correlation. Then you cannot avoid to get non-local deterministic correlation. Because mixture of these two will give you this correlation. So till you don't break this correlation in terms of deterministic correlation, there is no non-locality. It is compatible with a special relativity. But if your dream is to break this correlation in terms of deterministic theory, then that deterministic theory becomes non-local. This is the essence of Bell's inequality, Bell's theorem. Of course, if you want to break this correlation is very, very powerful. So if you want to break this correlation in terms of deterministic correlation, then those all deterministic correlation becomes non-local. All these deterministic correlation become non-local. But quantum mechanics, the correlation is not that powerful. So quantum, if you break quantum correlation in terms of deterministic correlation, then some correlation may be local. But Bell's theorem is telling that not all the correlation can be local. This is the essence of Bell's theorem. So Bell's theorem in a nutshell tells that if we consider this CHSH game, that winning probability is bounded by 3 by 4. So Bell's theorem tells that if this probability in any no signaling theories goes beyond 3 by 4, then those no signaling correlation cannot be realized as mixture of only deterministic local correlation, as I told you. So there are some quantum correlation that cannot be reduced to mixture of only deterministic local correlation. So if you want to break the quantum correlation in terms of deterministic correlation, then some of those deterministic correlation has to be non-local. This is the essence of Bell's theorem. Yeah, I am come to my last slide. So in the last slide, I am trying to mention something else. So if you have a no signaling theory but which violates Bell's inequality, that theory is a particular nature that you cannot get rid of probability. Because if you want to get rid of the probability, you cannot avoid non-locality. So to avoid non-locality, you have to be satisfied with probability. So in this theory, you see probability becomes irreducible by nature, not by Bond's rule, not by quantum postulates. Nature is telling you that if you have powerful correlations which violates Bell's inequality, then you to have a no signaling theory like quantum mechanics, you cannot get rid of probability. Probability is essential. Probability must be intrinsic. So no signaling correlation, if they are violates Bell's inequality, they are irreducibly probabilistic. That means lack of realism on the part of results of local measurement. So local measurement result cannot be deterministic. So David Marmin made a very nice comments regarding this thing. That he is telling that correlation is real. So he is comparing this thing with quantum mechanics. So in quantum, what is electrodynamics trying to tell us? It simply tells that fields in empty space have physical reality, what Einstein emphasized. The medium that people thought to be ether that supports them does not. So David Marmin, one of the most profound physicists of our time, he came to this statement that correlation of physical reality, that means in this case, product of the thing is plus one. So global thing is very definite, plus one or minus one. But a local thing does not. That means correlation of physical reality, that which they correlate, does not. That means the subsystem that have this correlation, they don't have physical reality. That means they don't have predetermined values for the observables. with this statement of David Marmin. Let us thank you all for patiently hearing. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Professor Kaur, for an extremely illuminating talk. Now it's open for questions and discussions. Students, please unmute yourself. You are in, here, then you can ask questions.
There are some questions in the chat box. May I read them for you?
Yeah, please read them. Yeah.
So Sohan asks, why do we consider minus one correlation for the last case?
No. This game we have. So we are free to choose a game. We are free to choose a game. We have that game has been designed by looking at CHSH inequality. So game you can design by yourself. That you have that freedom to choose the game. But from the game, you are concluding something powerful. That is the interesting part of this. Game has been designed in such a way that with any local strategy, you cannot do it. You can win this game. So it has to be cunningly chosen.
It would be better to say that you can put minus one in any of them. And that will also
work. That you can.
There's nothing special in this B2. You can take any one of them. Can take.
So you change the indices, we will automatically change. So,
there's one more question.
There is one more question. Aniket asks, if non-local phenomena exist, are the phenomena limited to the entanglement revealed in the violations of the Bell's inequality, or can information, can conserved quantities also move in non-local way?
If you tell that information can move in a non-local way, that is completely discarded because quantum mechanics is compatible with no signaling theory. But if someone tells that whether non-locality plays a role, the kind of non-locality that I have been discussing here, it may not play any role in quantum, in some of the quantum information processing tasks like quantum teleportation, quantum dense coding, because Robert Spakens could discover a model theory where he showed that there are quantum teleportation, dense coding, but the theory is completely local. So the kind of non-locality that we have been discussing here, that does not have an essential role in quantum teleportation and quantum dense coding and some of the other quantum devices, but it gave rise to some other quantum information processing tasks like device-independent cryptography and randomness generation, where it plays a very key role in some information processing tasks like this. I don't know whether I have answered this question, but if needed, the question can be further repeated.
Okay. So, Guru, can I ask the question?
Yeah.
So you in this slide, you said that any deterministic model, any local deterministic model cannot reproduce that correlation because So my point is that
my point is that for the same correlation, if you want to have deterministic correlation, then that deterministic correlation becomes non-local.
Yeah. So that means if you make a different choice, that means you are indicating a choice. That is, if you take the indeterministic model, indeterministic values in such a case, you will have the local model.
So if you introduce probability, then you get rid of no signaling theory.
Yeah.
But still, this no signaling theory is non-local in the sense. In which sense? In the sense that if you want to have a deterministic model, that deterministic model will be non-local. In this sense, this correlation is non-local.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But by itself, it is not non-local, like quantum mechanics.
Yeah.
So if either you accept these probabilities, and if you are not satisfied with probability, you want to break it in terms of deterministic theory, then that deterministic theory has to be necessarily non-local. This is the essence of Bell's theorem. But Bell's theorem deals with not this very powerful correlation, but much weaker correlation like 2√2.
I have a question. Like Bell's bound, let's say 3/4 of quantum mechanics, does it depend on formation formulation of the theory?
Repeat this question.
Formulation of theory, like PT symmetric, if you consider symmetric quantum mechanics, will it be exactly the same bound as in standard mechanics?
No, but this condition is only has two nature, that theory is local realistic theory. That's all.
PT symmetric is another form of quantum theory, right?
If your theory is local realistic, then using correlation for those theory, the winning condition for the winning probability for this game cannot go beyond 3/4. It is independent of any other particular nature of that theory.
Okay, sir. Thank you so much.
Any more questions?
There is one more question by Aniket in the chat box. He asks, how does the existence or absence of non-local phenomena elucidate the proper interpretation of the fundamental nature of quantum physics?
Please repeat.
How does the existence or absence of non-local phenomena elucidate the proper interpretation of the fundamental nature of quantum physics?
See, quantum mechanics is quantum mechanics. It has some rules given by description of observable state and finally measurement rules and finally bond probability rule. So quantum mechanics is quantum mechanics. But if you want to realize, if you are not very satisfied with quantum mechanics because it does give you probability, not reality, like in classical mechanics. But if you have a dream to have a more fundamental theory, which is consistent with quantum mechanical results, but which is itself not quantum mechanics, then those theory will have some property. And if you want it to be deterministic, then at the same time, you have to accept it to be non-local. So you cannot get rid of quantum probabilities by introducing reality without taking locality, without taking non-locality. If you want a very real kind of theory, as you have in other areas, then at the same time, you have to accept non-locality. So that is the main component that it adds to ideas of in the literature of foundation of quantum mechanics, that you this is final statement. You cannot get rid of non-locality if you want to replace quantum mechanics by some deterministic or realistic theory.
Now, since we have a few more minutes left, can I request you, Guru, to explain a little bit how these adjunctive concepts are finding application in quantum cryptography?
Yeah, this is very important because cryptography was first discovered by Professor Charles Bennett and Brashad, but they used quantum particles, quantum measurements, and all these quantum principles to establish that you have secure cryptography, and that is indeed secure. But for that, you have to believe in quantum devices like state preparation and measurements. You have to be sure that I have given this particular state and whatever devices have been given, it is measuring sigma x and sigma z. You have to believe those devices. But if you use Bell's inequality, I mean violation of this Bell's inequality, that I was trying to tell, that Bell's inequality also tells you that to have a no signaling theory, for the particular nice correlation, you cannot get rid of these probabilities. So this can be exploited to show that you can have secure quantum key generation without believing your devices. You have to believe only in statistics. So you buy your devices, you get the results, see the statistics, and from the statistics, nothing but you see the Bell violation, and from the Bell violation, you can be satisfied that you have not been deceived by the seller of these devices. So you need not test the devices. You look at the statistics and become sure that you have been given proper correlation to generate the secure key. So this is device independent cryptography, and there are huge potential for research in this area, and that are going on also. Yeah.
Okay, so thank you, Guru, for an extremely elucidating and very nice talk. And hopefully, more questions, if somebody has, they can send you by email also.
Yeah, sure. And if needed, I can send the talk also, PPT.
Yeah, that would be nice.
Talk can be found in YouTube channel.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, Guruda. As usual, a very interesting, very nice talk.
Okay. I am leaving because I have to go to the institute and I have some official work. Thank you, Prapani Gai.
Thank you. Yeah. Okay. See, Alok.